Hello everybody, and welcome to our lesson on topic 5.3, Classification of Biodiversity. Now, in today's lesson, we're actually going to be talking about taxonomy. A taxa is a group of living things. So in taxonomy, we're going to be talking about how scientists organize life. How do we decide which species are more closely related to others, and how do we name them accordingly? So let's dive right in. When species are discovered, they are given scientific names using the binomial system. The binomial system of names for species is universal among biologists and has been agreed and developed at a series of congresses. So first off, what does the word binomial actually mean? Well, it means two names. So this is a two-name system where scientists actually meet. And at these big meetings, we'll choose the names for every species. So each species has two names. This is their scientific name. And they're used together to be very precise about which organism we're talking about. This system is called binomial nomenclature, where binomial means two names, binome, and nomenclature means name-making. So nomen is name, and clature is choosing or making. So the two names that we give all organisms are their species name and their genus name. Now again, a species is essentially the smallest truly recognized biological grouping of organisms. A species is a group of organisms with similar characteristics that are capable of successfully breeding to produce fertile offspring. I guess it's not truly the smallest because we can talk about populations, for example, a population of a city. But when we're talking about classification and taxonomy, a species is the smallest group. Now, all species are part of a genus as well, where every species is classified into a genus, which is a group of similar species. So, when we're writing the names, we always put the genus name first. This is always written with a capital letter. The second word in the binomial name is the species, which goes after the genus and is written in a lowercase letter. So, for example, for humans, the species name is Homo sapiens, where Homo actually comes from the word for dirt. This comes from old, essentially biblical or Christian ideas that God created man from the earth. So from the earth or humus, that's where we get the name for the food as well. And sapiens is sapientia or wisdom. So wise dirt is what we are named after. Now really when we think about this, you can think of Homo as like a family name. We are currently the only living Homo, but there used to be others. For example, Neanderthals were Homo neanderthalensis. There was Homo habilis and Homo erectus. These were all different species, not capable of successfully interbreeding to produce fertile offspring, but close enough to us to be in the same grouping. So really think of Homo as a last name. Sapiens is like a first name. So if this was me, this would be Briner Christopher. And here's the thing, there are far too many species. Current estimates predict up to 8.7 million species on Earth. There basically aren't that many names, which means that we sometimes reuse the species names. Meanwhile, there are only about 500,000 genera. This is the plural for genus. And that means that we actually have enough words that every genera has a different word. So, what that means is, for example, dogs are Canis familiaris. There are other species which are familiaris. Felix catus is a cat, but if it was Felix familiaris, that wouldn't make it more similar to a dog. The species name, even if they're the same, in this case, they have to have the same genus name too, in order to actually be the same organism. So really think of it like last name, first name. In English, when I introduce myself, I normally do it the other way around. Hi, my name is Christopher Briner. Not all cultures do this. So for example, in Japan, traditionally, you always say the last name first. Currently, the Prime Minister of Japan is Abe Shinzo. I grew up calling this man Shinzo Abe, because his first name is Shinzo, in the same way that my name is Christopher. His family name is Abe, in the way that mine is Briner. But in Japan, and many other cultures, Chinese and Korean cultures as well, usually you put the family name first, followed by the given name. And Japan wants you to use that, even if you're speaking English. So they want me to call Shinzo Abe, Abe Shinzo, which I will do. Now, to a certain degree, that almost makes more sense. Because which name gives more information about me? How many Christophers are there on Earth? There must be millions. But how many Briners? Probably less. So by calling myself Briner Christopher, you actually get the more important piece of information first. Knowing that I'm a Briner probably says more about me than knowing that my first name is Christopher. And in the same way, we put the genus name first. This is like the last name, the family name. And knowing the genus of an organism actually helps us identify it better than knowing the species, because there are millions of different species. Now, when we're writing binomial nomenclature, names, if they're written by hand, we usually underline the names. And if we type them, we put them in italics. Sometimes if you're ever reading research, they will actually put the name of the person who discovered the species in brackets afterwards. Now note that who gets to choose the names? Basically, the first person to discover it gets to choose the name. There's a few rules. You're not allowed to name it after yourself, but you can name it after other people. So you can name it after your teacher or a friend. Because of that, there have been some pretty funny animal names. For example, one person wanted to name something after Beyoncé and found this species of fly with a golden butt and decided to name it after Beyoncé. So the genus of the species, the genus of this organism is already there, Scapsia, but it's Scapsia Beyoncé. Another person decided to name a sea sponge after Spongiforma squarepantsy. So this is literally SpongeBob SquarePants. And someone else decided to name some extinct turtles after the Ninja Turtles. So we have the Nenjimus, which are a taxa of turtles. So again, whenever we look at a species, we put the genus name first with a capital letter, and then the species name with a lowercase letter, and if we type it, it has to be in italics. The genus name tells us more information. The species name is allowed to be repeated, but if they're not in the same genus, they're not related at all, or at least not related closely. Now, the first guy who actually came up with all these names was a man named Carolus Linnaeus. And Carolus Linnaeus literally walked around and tried to rename all living things. When he did this, he was a little bit racist. He actually made different species of humans, even though we can clearly all successfully reproduce to produce fertile offspring. And how relevant is the social context of scientific work to the methods and finding of research? You know, to what degree does our culture affect our science? And that's a really interesting TOK question to consider. In any case, let's zoom out now and talk about all living things, now that we know how to name them. All organisms are classified into three domains. A domain is the largest classification of living things. So literally all life is grouped into one of these three. There are The eukaryotes, which we know well, you are a eukaryote. This is plants, animal, fungi, and these are organisms that have a nucleus with a membrane and ADS ribosomes, etc. Then there are bacteria, or prokaryotic cells. Prokaryotic life with a nucleoid and 70S ribosomes, etc., etc. And then there's one weird one, archaea. Archaea, you don't need to know too much about. They have a slightly different cell wall, they look like bacteria, but they're different enough that we put them in their own domain. So, all living things are in one of three domains. You need to know this. Eukarya, bacteria, or archaea. Yeah, you just need to know that. Now, under these domains, there are seven more levels. So taxonomists classify species using this hierarchy. And underneath domain, you have kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species, where genus and species are the ones we use for binomial nomenclature. So again, kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. Now, each of these gets more and more specific. So a domain might include all eukaryotes. That includes protists and fungus and plants and animals. A kingdom would be something like animals. So this is all heterotrophs that do not have cell walls but have lysosomes, etc., etc. Then you get into phyla, which are even more specific. Then mammals, which is the class, an order, a family, a genus, and then a species, where here we have Ursus americanus, the American black bear, which is a species because they can successfully interbreed to produce fertile offspring. All members of the species are going to be in the same genus, family, order, class, phylum, kingdom, and domain. But within a kingdom, there might be many phyla, and there will for sure be many classes and orders, etc. So basically, it's getting more and more specific. You are required to know this order, and there's a few mnemonic devices to help you do this. For example, starting with domain. So domain, kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. D for domain, K for kingdom, P for phyla, etc., etc. Do kids play chess on fine green spaces? Or dumb Kevin's poor cow only feels good sometimes? Or dear King Philip cried out for good soup? I recommend memorizing one of these to help you remember the order. Because if I can remember the order of letters, I can remember the others. I will also just say all of these in plural, that way you've heard the words. One kingdom, two kingdoms. One phylum, two phyla. One class, two classes. One order, two orders. One family, two families. One genus, two genera. One species, two species. So the ones that are weird, by the way, are phyla and genera. But if you say phylums and genuses, no one really cares. But so in our classification of nature, the genus and all accompanying higher taxa, or levels, consist of all the species that have evolved from a common ancestor. So basically, all animals have a common ancestor, which was farther away than all chordates, which was farther away than all mammals, etc. And the further down you go, the more recent the common ancestor. All organisms evolved from Luca, the last universal common ancestor, but the more detailed the group, the more recent the ancestor. So we can really think of this almost like a cladogram or a phylogenetic tree, where the more specific it is, the more recent the common ancestor. Again, a species is one of several in a genus. A genus is one of several in a family, and it gets more and more general as you go up, or more and more specific as you go down the classifications. In this diagram, up and down or reverse, but... Okay, you are required to know an example of a full classification of one plant and one animal species. Now let me just say, I do not think this is worth knowing. Definitely know one animal. I'm going to make you guys know humans. But to know a full plant, it's usually a 2 or 3 point question that only comes up every few years, and it's huge for memorization. So I will give you one, and I require you to memorize one for animals, but if you don't want to memorize one for plants, that's fine for me. It might come up, but it won't be worth many points, and it's very rare. So anyway, here is a mnemonic device. All cool men prefer having heavy sideburns. The sideburns are these parts of your hair here, so think of Elvis Presley. Or anyone can make pretty healthy hot soup. So, this mnemonic device helps us memorize the full classification for humans. Animalia chordata, Mammalia primata, Hominidae Homo sapien. Or all cool men prefer having heavy sideburns. Now, animals mean that we are heterotrophs that have lysosomes and ADS ribosomes and no cell wall. Chordates essentially means we have bones. Mammalia means we're mammals. We make breast milk and have fur. Primates makes us related to monkeys. Hominidae means that we walk on two legs. Homo means dirt, and sapiens means wise. So we are an animal with bones that has breast milk, that's a monkey, that walks on two legs, that is wise dirt. Now, here is the full classification for plants. And again, I do not require you to know this, but if you want to memorize it, because it might come up, here is one that is a bit easier. So the late tulip, this is a flower that blossoms late. It's a plant, so plantae. It's an angiosperm, so a flowering plant. It is a monocot, meaning that it has one cotyledon in its seeds. Lilales means that it's part of a lily, or lilac, sorry, flower, type of order. Lilaceae, Tulipa tarda, and I like this species name, the late tulip, Tulipa tarda. So honestly, the reason I wouldn't memorize this is if you can remember Tulipa tarda or another one of your favorite plants. One of my favorite is Pinus ponderosa, which is the ponderous pine or a pine tree. And you can remember plantae and angiosperm, which you're going to have to learn anyway. That can already get you 1, 2, 3, 4 of the 7 levels. So you can already get 1 point pretty easily just by remembering plantae, angiosperm, Tulipa tarda. So anyway, here are 2 full classifications. You are required to know the one for animals. The one for plants is bonus if it comes up. So this classification of nature helps us identify species and predict the characteristics they will share. So natural classification actually refers to grouping organisms based on their similarities, then identifying their characteristics. There are other ones, but you're not required to know them. But I'll just say that this method sometimes means that we make mistakes. It helps us show evolutionary relationships and predict characteristics, but as new information comes up, taxonomists need to reclassify groups, often because of DNA. So, a disadvantage of this classification method is that we need to update it pretty often. For example, humans, we once upon a time classified ourselves as a completely different kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. It's a completely different family from other great apes, but then based on DNA evidence, we now rank ourselves as part of them, essentially. We are all within the same family, even though we obviously have different genus and species. So, let's talk about one example of this all before we finish for the day. I want you guys, the IB requires you to know 4 different plant phyla and their characteristics. So phyla, kingdom, phylum. So the second one right under plants, the 4 main types of plants. Bryophytes, Filicinophytes, Coniferophytes, and Angiospermophytes. The fact that you need to know this one is why memorizing half of this is a little bit easier, because plant and angiosperm should be pretty easy. So, let's talk about these. First off, plants. The kingdom is plants, they're in the domain of eukaryotes, and plants are photosynthetic. They are autotrophs. They have chlorophyll in their chloroplasts with cellulose cell walls and big vacuoles, and they store starch for energy. That's what makes them plants. The four main phyla of plants are bryophytes, also known as mosses. In Italian, this would be muschia. Then there are ferns. Ferns are the filicinophytes, and they're famous for having these triangular leaves. Then you have conifers. These are pine trees with pine cones. They have the needles as their leaves, and they tend to live in cold places. And finally, angiosperms, any plants with flowers. All grasses and almost all trees are angiosperms. Mosses is the green fuzz that will grow on a tree. Ferns are the ones that you see underneath the forest in a rainforest. Conifers are the pine trees. And then angiosperms are the flowering plants. So let's go through these one at a time. Bryophytes are mosses. They have no roots. Instead of roots, they have kind of this hair that grows out of the bottom of them, but they're not true roots. They don't look like stems. And these fake roots are called rhizoids, and they look a lot like root hairs in angiosperms. They have no true leaves or stems. They don't have leaves or stems. They just kind of have fuzz, and they don't have bark either. Because of that, they have no xylem or phloem. They have no blood vessels, essentially. They're very small. They're never really more than half a meter tall, but usually much, much smaller, usually like 1 centimeter. And they don't have seeds. Instead, they have spores. Now, here's some pictures of moss, and you can see, small and fuzzy, and they have these fake roots called rhizoids, and fake leaves and stems, they don't have real ones. And at the top, instead of seeds, they have spores. Spores are their gametes, and they will release the spores into the water, so they can only reproduce if there's water. The spores meet in the water, which is where fertilization happens, and the moss grows. This means you can actually paint with moss. If you take some moss like this and throw it into a blender with some water, all the spores get mixed in there. You can then use that as paint, and wherever you paint, moss will grow because the spores are in the water. This stalk type thing that kind of looks like a stem is called a phallus, and at the top you have a sporangium. You don't really need to know those words, but again, they have no roots. They have rhizoids instead. You do need to know that word. They have no leaves or stems. Instead of stems, they have a phallus. They have no seeds. Instead, they have spores. You have to know that one. Okay, let's talk about the next one. From mosses, let's now talk about ferns. Ferns, their fancy name, their phylum name is filicinophyte. And they have real roots, leaves, and stems, with real xylem and phloem, real, essentially, sap vessels instead of blood vessels. Their leaves tend to have this triangular or pinnate shape. It is good to know the word pinnate, and it means triangular. They can be much bigger. There are some trees that are ferns, up to 15 meters tall. But they also reproduce with spores, just like moss. This means you only find ferns in places with water. So, here is a fern, and if you lift the fern and look underneath the leaves, you can see these packets of spores. These are the sporangia. So when it rains, the raindrops fall on the leaves and go underneath, and as they drip down, the water takes some spores with them into the soil where new ferns can grow. Next, we have the conifers, or pine trees. These again have real roots, leaves, and stems, all of them having vascular tissue. They have these pines, you know, literally these needle-like leaves with thick waxy cuticles to prevent evaporation. And you have to know, they have real seeds that are in cones. This is where they actually get their name from. They are trees with cones. They make real trees up to 100 meters tall, or at least on that scale, and they have cones with seeds in them and pollen, like most normal plants. So here we see pine trees in a winter environment, and we can see needle-like leaves with cones on them. And if you like eating pine seeds in pesto, that's where they come from pine trees or conifer-phytes. The last phyla you need to know are the angiospermophytes, also known as flowering plants. These have true roots, leaves, and stems. They have flowers and fruit to reproduce. So again, they have pollen, but flowers and seeds in their fruit. And they make real trees, but also all grasses. So when you think of a plant, you're probably thinking of an angiosperm. They're some of the most successful plants in the world.
Bryophyta or mosses are lacking many structures, such as true leaves or roots. They only have tiny root hairs known as rhizoids, and they don't have any vascular tissue or wood for structural support. In addition, they don't have any cuticles on their leaves. Mosses reproduce by releasing a spore from a sporangium that then develops into another plant. Villicinophyta, or ferns, in contrast to mosses, do have true roots, leaves, and stems, and are considered vascular plants as they have xylem and phloem. Their leaves are usually pinnate, that is, divided into leaflets, and like mosses, they reproduce by releasing spores. Coniferophytes, or conifers, are shrubs and trees that have woody stems and complete vascular systems. They are characterized by having narrow, long, thin, needle-like leaves which have a thick, waxy cuticle. These plants produce male and female reproductive units separately in the form of cones. Angiospermatophytes, or flowering plants and grasses, have true roots, stems, and leaves with waxy cuticles. Like conifers and ferns, they are vascular plants with xylem and phloem. However, their seeds are produced from ovules in the ovary, and along with the pollen grains, these are used for reproduction.
So again, here are the main four phyla: bryophytes, villicinophytes, coniferophytes, and angiospermophytes. Mosses have no true leaves, roots, or stems, with no vascular tissue, no vessels. They reproduce with spores and have rhizoids instead of roots. Villicinophytes, or ferns, have roots, leaves, and stems. They have vascular bundles, but they also reproduce with spores, and they have pinnate leaves. Coniferophytes have true roots, leaves, and stems. They have vascularization. They have seeds now instead of spores, which are in cones. And they have cones and these needle-like leaves. Angiosperms have leaves, roots, and stems. They have vascularization. They have seeds in fruits, and they have flowers. And these are all the grasses and trees. So there you have it. Those are the four main types of phyla of plants. And that's the end for 5.3 part 1. Thanks so much for watching, and have a great rest of your day. Ciao!